There's a story about two pastors that die at the same time and thus end up at heaven, right in front of the pearly gates. Now, they think because of their life that they're going to be able to walk right on into the pearly gates, but they're stopped right there by St. Peter, who says, now, hold on a second, our computers are down. We need to run a little background check here, so it's going to take about a week. So if you just want to step off to the side. And the two pastors kind of disappointed. And St. Peter says, okay, if you want to go back to earth, you can, but you can't go back as humans. So one pastor immediately says, you know, I always wanted to be an eagle, flying high over the Rocky Mountains. So be it, says St. Peter, and off he flies. The other pastor looks at St. Peter and he says, will any of this count? And St. Peter says, no, I'm telling you, the computers are down. We have no way of tracking anything. And so the pastor says, you know, I always wanted to be a stud. And St. Peter says, so be it. Off it becomes. Well, a week later, the computers are fixed. God comes up to St. Peter and says, okay, it's time for you to recall those pastors. Are you going to have any trouble finding them? And St. Peter says, well, not the first one. He is flying high over with a bunch of eagles over the Rocky Mountains. But that second one might be a little tricky. And God says, well, why is that? And St. Peter says, he's on a snow tire in North Dakota somewhere. The moral of the story is be careful what you ask for. We are walking through the judges in this season of Lent. Interesting exercise. This is a section that we don't talk about much. And we certainly have a hard time telling these stories in polite company. Now, before we get to today's passage, let's talk about where we have been, how we got to this point. The judges were the leaders of the Hebrew people before Israel had a king. These were not legal scholars. These were people that were actually chosen by God for something specific. And usually, it was to bring Israel peace. Now, for the most part, we have seen this typical cycle. Ehud defeated the nation of Moab. Deborah helped their military leader defeat the Canaanites. Then the following week, we talked about Gideon. Now, we didn't talk much about who Gideon defeated, so I recommend that you read Judges chapter 7 on your own. It is a fascinating story, a very cunning story about how Gideon was able to defeat the Midianites. And there we have this cycle. There's peace, and then Israel does something to disrupt that cycle. A foreign power takes over. Israel cries out to God. God chooses a judge. The judge defeats the enemy, and then we have peace again, and thus the cycle. There is some variations, and yes, there is a lot of violence. Now, last week we had the story of Abimelech. Abimelech doesn't quite fit into this pattern. He declares himself king. And he does everything in his power, or everything that he can to hold on to that power, and it eventually leads him to death. I like to think of Abimelech as kind of an aberration, an outlier of this cycle. Because today, when we get into today's story, we're right back into this cycle again. And here is where Steve is going to tell us the story. And one, the part that we've all been waiting for about what takes place that we shared with the kids. So go ahead and read our passage for today.
Today's reading will be taken from the Good News Bible, Judges chapter 10, verses 6 through 8. It said, once again, the Israelites sinned against the Lord by worshiping the Baals and the Ashtoreth, as well as the gods of Syria, Sidon, and Moab, of Ammon, and of Philistia. They abandoned the Lord and stopped worshiping him. So the Lord became angry with the Israelites and let the Philistines and the Ammonites conquer them. For 18 years they oppressed and persecuted all the Israelites who lived in the Amorite country east of the Jordan River in Gilead. Judges 11, 29 through 40 continues saying, then the Spirit of the Lord came upon Jephthah. He went through Gilead and Manasseh and returned to Mizpah in Gilead and went on to Ammon. Jephthah promised the Lord, if you will give me victory over the Ammonites, I will burn as an offering the first person that comes out of my house to meet me when I come back from the victory. I will offer that person to you as a sacrifice." So Jephthah crossed the river to fight the Ammonites, and the Lord gave him victory. He struck at them from the Aor to the area around Minnith, 20 cities in all, and as far as Cable Karamim. There was a great slaughter, and the Ammonites were defeated by Israel. When Jephthah went back home to Mizpah, there was his daughter coming out to meet him, dancing and playing the tambourine. She was his only child. When he saw her, he tore his clothes in sorrow and said, "Oh, my daughter, you are breaking my heart. Why must it be you that causes me pain? I have made a solemn promise to the Lord, and I cannot take it back." So she told him, "If you have made a promise to the Lord, do what you said you would do to me, since the Lord has given you revenge on your enemies, the Ammonites." But she asked her father, "Do this one thing for me. Leave me alone for 2 months, so that I can go with my friends to wander in the mountains and grieve that I must die a virgin." He told her to go and sent her away for 2 months. She and her friends went up into the mountains and grieved because she was going to die unmarried and childless. After 2 months, she came back to her father. He did what he had promised the Lord, and she died, still a virgin. This was the origin of the custom in Israel that the Israelite women would go out for 4 days every year to grieve for the daughter of Jephthah of Gilead. May God add his blessing and his understanding to the reading of his word.
Thank you, Stan. My first thought was, when I heard this passage, was how in the world am I going to preach on this? Then I thought about my 3 daughters. Then I thought about the daughter of Jephthah. She's never given a name. She really is a pawn in the system. In fact, she's almost kind of blamed for the one who comes out and has to be the brunt of this. And it's the story really is about poor old Jephthah that's not going to have anyone carry on his name. Then I thought about the bigger question. Why does God fulfill this vow of sacrifice? Then I thought about every promise that I ever made and every promise that's ever been made of me. Then I thought, you know, how would Hollywood treat this? You know, Hollywood, the big screen, the TV show, you see it all the time. There just seems to be going towards a dead end, literally, for all those involved. And you're kind of wondering yourself, how are they going to get out of this mess? And then all of a sudden, there's an unexpected event, a twist. It's like, oh, we didn't see that coming. Great, happy ending. Now we can end the story on a good note. But there is no good note, no happy ending with this story. Mike Beneshek is a pastor in Oregon. He's a good friend of mine. We went to college and seminary together. And I'm indebted to Mike for the ideas of this sermon series. He has this to say when he preached on this passage. It was almost 10 years ago, we were driving up to North Dakota for family vacation. Why North Dakota? Because the kids were still very young. My wife and I made a promise to each other, 50 by 50. 50 states by the time we were 50. She's still at North Dakota on her list. Be careful what you promise. We figured it would be better to take care of North Dakota when the kids didn't care where we go, instead of waiting until they're teenagers saying, "Why do we have to go to North Dakota?" Well, kids, it was either Disney or North Dakota, but we made a promise. We actually like North Dakota. We visited the Capitol, got to visit the governor, who asked us, "Why North Dakota?" We made a promise, and we keep our promises. But also on that trip, our kids were old enough to look outside the car and comment on the passing scenery. And I committed a common parental sin. The boys would see passing parks or playground equipment or someone's backyard who had a swing set, and they would ask, "Can we go there sometime? Can we play at the park?" The answer, of course, was no. But how do you explain to a little kid property rights or keeping on a schedule, or for the love of everything holy, we can't stop at every slide we see? So I said the parental line, "Maybe someday." Maybe someday, which his parent taught for not now, probably not ever. But it pacified them until they saw the next swing set, and I'd have to say, maybe someday. Not really a promise, but a little deception going on there. I still use it. Dad, can we go to Disneyland? Maybe someday. Dad, can we get a dog? Maybe someday. Dad, can I get a tattoo over my dead body? To which they would respond, maybe someday. Be careful what you promise. This morning, we have a story out of Judges about promises that get out of hand. Jephthah is raised to fight the Ammonites who were oppressing Israel. No one is able to defeat them. And the people of Israel, they come up to Jephthah and they say, if you and your friends can save us, then you can rule over us. More promises. Maybe Jephthah just wants to be accepted by the people. Maybe Jephthah sees an opportunity here. So he takes up the challenge and he wins. He actually defeats the Ammonites. And before the battle, he has a special anointing from God. A bold step. He makes a vow, and that's why we remember this story so many centuries later. Promises, promises. Be careful what we ask for. An elderly man in Phoenix calls his son in New York and says, I have to ruin your day, but I have to tell you that your mother and I are divorcing. 45 years of misery is enough. Pop, what are you talking about? The son screams. We can't stand the sight of each other any longer, the old man says. We're sick of each other, and I'm sick of talking about this to you, so you call your sister in Chicago and tell her. And then hangs up the phone. Frantic, the son calls his sister, who explodes on the phone. Like heck, they're getting divorced, she shouts. I'll take care of this. She calls Phoenix immediately and screams at the old man, you are not getting divorced. Don't do a single thing until I get there. I'm calling my brother back, and we'll be there tomorrow. Until then, don't do a thing. Do you hear me? Hangs up the phone. The old man hangs up the phone, turns to his wife, and says, okay, they're coming for Thanksgiving and paying their own way. What do we tell them for Christmas now? The moral of the story is be careful of the trap. Be careful what you ask for. Be careful of the promises we make. I think maybe we're looking at this maybe the wrong way. I think really we should be looking at is how strong is one's word, one promise, one's vow anymore. I was leading a youth group. This is many years ago, many churches ago. And it was getting Christmas time, and some of the youth suggested we go Christmas caroling. I suggested that we go on a hayrack ride. They loved the idea. They started thinking about the songs they were going to sing and the friends that they were going to invite. And so I went about the planning. I called up a farmer who brought in a trailer. And I called up another farmer that brought in the hay. And I found an adult that would bring his pickup truck in. And he was going to carry us around. And then I contacted the shut-ins. And we created the schedule. I even bought cocoa so that we would have when we came back. Now, as you know, December can be kind of cold. And it was one of those days when the temperature was dropping. And this was a youth group that usually averaged about 30 kids on a Sunday evening. And that Sunday evening, we had 3 show up. I'll tell you, my heart sank. And I thought to myself, where is the promise? Where is the excitement? I thought about, where is the long underwear when it gets cold? I mean, what's going on here? We are a broken people. How many of us have made a promise that we knew we couldn't keep? My mom has never finished college. When her mother was dying of cancer, my mom promised her mom that she would finish school. My mom has yet to fulfill that promise. What if we had to keep every single promise that we ever make? Mike, that pastor friend of mine from Oregon, says this about that. Is, how many playgrounds do I have to visit in the Dakotas? Kids, I know you're 18, but I promise, let's go. I'll tell you this, I'd be very, very careful about what I promise. I have some practical examples of promises right here. Many of us know what this is. This is a dollar bill. This is a promise. The United States is not on the gold standard anymore. There is nothing backing this up. It is just a piece of paper, but it is a promise, it is a vow. If I give this to Steve, to me it's $1, to Steve it's $1, and when Steve gives this to someone else, it is $1, it is a promise. I have another promise right here. I don't think we have to describe what this represents. Here's another one. It's a bill. We spent the money, and so I promise to pay it back. We all know about these promises, these vows. And we all know that each one of these can be broken. I have a family member that has a bankruptcy in their past. Just before they declared bankruptcy, they came out to visit us, and she was carrying this really, really nice new phone. It was expensive. And we said to her, "How can you afford that phone?" And she said to us, "I'm going to declare bankruptcy soon, so I'm going on a spending spree." This is the mentality of the land. We even have a president who has said about his numerous bankruptcies, "I have used brilliantly the bankruptcy laws of this country." Really? Really? What happened to the vows we make and should make? We are a broken people. And each one of us has broken a promise a time or two. How often have we said to a child that is acting up, "Okay, you do that one more time and we're out of here." And then a little bit later we say, "Okay, that's enough, you do it again, and this time we're out of here." The kid knows we're bluffing. And our integrity is on the line. So what does Jephthah do? He tells his daughter about the vow. And all she asks is that she can go away for 2 months. Now, I'm surprised she came back. If my parents told me, Seth, you have been sacrificed, but you can go out for 2 months, I would think twice before I came back. Now, there are some scholars that believe that she wasn't indeed burnt. That maybe she just made her life an offering to God. Lived in the temple, never married. Just dedicated her life to the Lord. Now we come to the part of what do we take home from this passage, time and sermon. Vows should not be made lightly. We should not make a vow lightly. Marriage vows, financial commitments, the vows that we make before this church and to everyone here. We should not promise something that we can't deliver on. We need to keep our commitments. And we need to do it out of thanksgiving. And certainly not out of desire to get something out of God. I mean, bargain vows are extremely dangerous. How many of us have heard this, or maybe we've even said to ourselves, "God, if you can get me out of this predicament, I will go to church all the time." Or, "God, if you get me out of this predicament, I will never ever cuss again." Jephthah said to God, "You do this, and I will do that." But here's the interesting part. Jephthah never had to make that promise in the first place. God never asked him of it. God had already told him that the battle was his. You see, God was faithful. We may never know why Jephthah made that vow. Maybe he just wanted to make sure that he was going to win. Maybe he kind of lacked some confidence, and he wanted to make sure, "Oh, by golly, I need to win this battle." And I think this is the correct answer. Jephthah was like the other characters in the book of Judges. He comes from a long line of broken people, making decisions that are not always well thought out. Ideas that we wish we could take back. Events we long for a do-over. Doesn't that sound like our own issues that we deal with? Stuff that we bring to the cross and wrestle with our own broken lives. We are a broken people. And we long to make a promise to God who will always, always remain faithful to us. John and Margie were married back in 1941. Both of them were rugged people, raised on the farmlands of America. Together they had big dreams, high hopes of becoming the most successful farmers in the United States. However, 4 years after they were married, and two children, Margie came down with polio. Had to spend the rest of her life in an iron lung. They were just in their 20s. Their dreams were shattered. There was no one to keep the house going, no one to raise the children, no real partner for John, no one to share his bed. John had to give up his lifelong dream of being a farmer to devote his life to taking care of Margie and the children. Many years later, when John and Margie were celebrating their 40th wedding anniversary, someone asked John how he had done it all those years. And John just simply answered, "I'm a Christian, and we try to keep our promises. And besides, I love her." A few years later, after Margie died, their son asked John how he had done it all those years. And again, John's answer was simple. "I never thought about doing anything else. You just do it, and God helps you." I love that line. You just do it, and God helps you. No matter how broken we can be in our life, we still serve a faithful God who always keeps a promise to us.